Hello? Yes. Okay. So yes, let's continue from where to where yesterday. So basically what we are trying to do, to remind you, is that if you look at KQPOK, the two-point function of dark matter, for example, in the universe, the function of K, it grows. And at some point for K of order 1 over megaparsec, doesn't matter, the density constant becomes of order 1, and the theory becomes strongly coupled. Now, here, the density constant is very slow, so for example, very small, so linear theory, for example, will be this. So this is linear. And this instead is non-linear. And we are trying to do what we are trying to do with the Fatty theory, or with any perturbative approach, but the Fatty theory is to try to have a theory that can reproduce better this curve in an approach that will fail here, but it will be arbitrarily precise on this side. Now, yesterday we wrote down the equations, all in the long mode, and we started to compute the while loop correction to the power spectrum. What I call the while loop, they were the fourth order correction in delta. We wrote delta as sum over n of delta n of k and a, and I use a as time, and we wrote that p of k was p11, the linear theory, plus p22, plus p31, plus p13, where p22 of k and a was d of a to the fourth over d of a0 to the fourth, the time-dependent part, times integrand d3q, 1 d3q2, delta 3 of k minus q1 minus q2, f2 of k minus of q1 q2, squared p of q1, p11 of q1, p11 of q2. We derived this in class, and p31 of k and a is actually equal to p13 of k and a was also d of a. With this we didn't compute, but it's very simple. P13 of k is delta 1, delta 3, and we take the expectation value like this. And this goes like d of a over d of a0 to the fourth, integral dq1, dq2, dq3. Delta 3 of k minus q1 minus q2 minus q3. Sorry, this can be actually way simplified. So, I mean, this has a very simple delta factor structure, so we can actually write it as dq, f3 of q minus q and k, p11 of q times p of k. Okay, so we call these other questions. But as usual, please feel free to ask all questions, interrupt me, call me, okay? So these are, we call these expression loops because you can see that here there is a, you can see first of all that this expression has a convolution integral over momenta. And also this one, even if you kill the delta function, one integral with the delta function, there is the other one which is surviving. Yes? Sorry? D3Q. D3Q1? Ah, yes, thank you. D3Q. Thank you. Okay, there is a diagrammatic way to represent. So, in fact, there are loops and very much similar to the loops in quantum field theory, there is a diagrammatic way to represent them. You can see, in fact, if this is time, you can see that, for example, remember that we had the second order solution, for example, delta 2. Delta 2 is actually integrand dq1, dq2 of, I mean, there was the growth factor, d of a square over d of a0. And then there was f2 of q1, q2, delta function of of k minus q1 minus q2, and then the linear solution, delta 1 of q1, delta 1 of q2. So the second order solution is a function of q1 and q2, and this can be represented like this. The delta 1 is some point x, delta 2 is some point x, is a vertex times, here we can put delta 1 of q1, delta 1, or some other x, for example, delta 1 of x1 and delta 1 of x2, if I wrote a real space instead of Fourier space. So this is the grammatic representation where the vertex is an insertion of this f2, f2 vertex. And so the loops, for example, p22 can be represented as a loop of one delta function, one delta 2, and another delta 2 at another point, okay, where these ones, each cross here, is an initial, a linear density fluctuation. And if you have this is given a certain delta linear of x1 and x2, there is a certain delta 2. Delta 2 is a certain x, which is given by this diagrammatic picture, which represents this. And and this is true in any realization, but in particular, it's true also in average. That is, one can take 2 delta 2 and compute the average, which is exactly what we do when we will compute P22. P22 is the expectation value of delta 2, delta 2. So what it means? It means that what we did yesterday was contract this with this and this with this. This circle means contraction. And then you can see that a loop has formed, a closed loop is formed. And this closed loop is in one-to-one correspondence with the fact that there is a one convolution integral here. So the same loops that you saw in Feynman diagrams are occur also in this classical theory. In particular, if you were to do quantum field theory in a so-called in-in, for computing in-in correlation function, not normal S-matrix, but slightly different quantities, which are typical, for example, in-in correlation function, then you will find in quantum field theory the identical diagram. That is the difference between classical field theory and stochastic classical field theory, like this one, and quantum field theory are very minor in a certain sense. So this is the diagram that represents P22. There is another diagram, analogous diagram that represents P31. P31, there is one solution which is linear. Here we put delta 1. Just for clarity, here there is delta 2, and this is delta 2. So one solution is the linear solution. And the other is delta 3. What is delta 3? Is the insertion twice of this vertex. So, because remember, we have only one vertex. The theory that we wrote the other day, yesterday, has only two quadratic vertices they can combine in one single, by doing the sum of the coefficients, one single quadratic vertex. There was no cubic vertex. So, indeed, you can see that this is a quadratic vertex. So, you can form a cubic theory by splitting a line like this, and then splitting it again. And then you can form a diagram by contracting this primordial fluctuation with this one, and this with this one. Now you see that I formed a closed loop here, which is exactly the single integral that we have here. So there is an identical structure to quantum field theory diagram in the larger structure. So you see that the answer takes the natural form of its expansion loops. Now, let's assume, for simplicity, in the universe, the power spectrum has this shape. So it has some places wiggles. It changes slope. It's a bit complicated because the universe has many scales. And Ravi, in fact, developed due to the transfer function, right? The non-triviality of the transfer function is exactly the non-triviality of the shape. But for learning a bit about the system, what it really represents, it's useful to, by the way, the non-triviality of the shape means that there are many scales in the problem. There are many scales. There's not just one single scale. But to understand a bit how this result can be organized in a perturbative expansion, Because somebody of you asked me yesterday, you, how much this count? I mean, I do a lot of computation, I don't know how much this count. Okay, let's see how it counts. And to understand very easily how it counts, let's imagine that the universe, the toy universe, which is not that different from ours, where P11k is 1 over k nonlinear cube, k over k nonlinear to the n plus 1, where n is some number, say 0.5 or some number between minus 1 and 1. Yes? I didn't write PT3. It could be there. Now, the reason why, yeah, there are many more here, but it's quite, delta is small. So there should be a sense in which each power of delta is a small correction, and the higher ones are even smaller. In a sense, we're trying to, you see, linear theory is wrong, but it's wrong by order one, but if you are very low k, it's wrong by very little. So here, the loop correction is smaller and very small, so each loop should be smaller and smaller. But yeah, PT3 is a two-loop term. Okay. But it's not evident yet that these loops are small. And in fact, if one is not careful, they're not even small, they're infinite. In fact, let's check. So let's imagine that there is the shape. These are called scaling universe or no scale universe, something. Okay. Take n minus 1 and 1. And let's compute P13, which is simpler. P13, okay, what do you find? You find d of a to the fourth. And then you see, what is confusing of this expression, as somebody yesterday in the question session asked, is that in principle, this integral has support at very, very high q. In particular, for q goes to infinity, for example, this statement, for q, f3 is of order k squared over q squared for q goes to infinity. So sq for q goes to infinity. This guy goes like k squared over q squared. So it is damped, but it's not so damped. In particular, this can grow much faster. And also notice that here this d3q. So it means dq q squared, so, which cancels the q squared upstairs. So if this is growing, this integral gets supports a large q. In fact, if I take a power spectrum like this, I do the integral and I find infinite. And infinite is not a good result. Nature is not infinite. I mean, maybe it's infinitely beautiful, but the result of the loop should not be infinite, okay? And thank you for understanding the joke. I'm very proud. And so it's infinite, so we cut it off. So that is finite. I put a cutoff. And then, of course, I get a cutoff in the numerator. I get lambda per k nonlinear to the n plus 1. Times k squared over k nonlinear square, p ok, p11 ok, plus a coefficient times k over k nonlinear to the n plus 1, to the n plus 3, p11 ok. Okay, so this is the result of the schematic result of the integral. So is this a good result? Well, it's better than infinite, but is it a correct result? No, it cannot be a correct result. Why? Does anyone can guess why? Just say. Yeah, exactly, very good. Because it depends on the cutoff lambda, but lambda is a number I put. And nature doesn't care of the number that I put. So the two results cannot care of the number that we put. It should be independent of our choice, of our choices. Exactly, so this means that, this means that the result is wrong in the sense that it is not going to match nature. Why is not going to match nature? Because we did a mistake. We used the equation of motion. This divergence comes from a very Hewitt number, or the dependence of the cutoff comes from a very Hewitt number. But remember that in our derivation, our equation, we are derived at a very low Hewitt number. They are wrong at short distances. In fact, you see, the equation that we got is similar to the one of a fluid, right? There's a continuity of momentum equation. But the solar system, it doesn't look like a fluid. It's two planets and empty space in the middle. So a very high Q, clearly this description is not the one on nature. So it's wrong, okay? So how do we fix for this mistake? Now, as you remember, so far, so this result, I'm physical. Well, but indeed, we didn't do the complete calculation, okay? Remember, we neglected the contribution. In the equation of motion, there was another term that we set to zero. This is what? The contribution of tau j. Okay. Indeed, tau j, which we express in terms of other fields, we took this, it was f very complicated, so was f very complicated of delta long, Laplacian of phi long, very complicated term, which we organize in the Taylor expansion. What was the, remember that it was entering the equation like v dot long plus da 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 dot equal I, equal di of dj tau j. Smoothed and taking the expectation value. Okay, so clearly the equation contained this term, we should include this term. Now this term, in fact, remember, was accounting for the effect of short distance physics that short distance physics had at long distances. Okay, so this term, in a sense, should tell me what short distance physics do at long distances. And you see that the mistake we did here was because we are using the loop diagram at very, very short distances. So it is somewhat expectable that this term should be able to correct the mistake I did here when I extrapolated my equation in the regime where the short distance where did not apply anymore. So it should correct for that mistake and give instead the right result. Okay, so this should happen. Indeed, that's what happens. In fact, remember that the leading term here, tau j, was some integral dt prime of some kernel of tt prime times some kernel tt prime times the first term was delta of t prime, delta of k. So the first term, so remember there was a Taylor expansion, and the first term was delta of k. Okay, let's try to use this term into the equation of motion. So the equation of motion contained v dot equal this, and the other equation was, which, by the way, then remember that we said that the velocity was divergent, didn't have any vorticity, so we can apply another derivative to get the equation for theta. And the equation for theta was theta dot equal blah, 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 I mean plus blah, 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 equal, now I'll take another derivative, so I get Laplacian of tau, two derivatives, di dj of tau j. Sorry, and the first term here, clearly, tau j was kernel delta a at time t prime times delta j. This was the first term I brought. I can write objects with different tensor structure, for example, with di, dj, but I need, another term could be di, dj, phi, and another term delta square, but a leading order, they're all degenerate, and this is the linear one. Then there are order terms which are quadratic, but these are smaller than this one. So let's see what the first one does. If the first contribution is barely important in this order, then the other one will be smaller and so negligible, because if the first is barely important, the next clearly are smaller and so they're negligible. So theta dot is this, and remember that there was a continuity equation that theta, delta dot plus theta equals zero. So this means that delta dot, if you can arrange the equation, delta dot, you can solve this equation considering this as a source, that is, let's consider this term when I plug this here, okay? Let's consider tau j as an interaction. And pretty much as we used, as for example, we used delta square or delta cube. Well, then we know how to solve for the effect of tau j. We know how to solve for that. This means that delta due to tau is equal to the integral in dt prime at a certain momentum k of the Green's function between t and t prime, the retarded Green's function between t and t prime, times this source here, which is the integral in t d double prime up to t prime of some kernel between t and t prime times this source. But remember, notice that there were the idj. Sorry, I forgot the d. So there were two derivatives here, which means that if I go to Fourier space k, this becomes k square delta ij. So k square delta j becomes k square, and then you have delta 1 of k. Now, you can see that since, crucially, the Green's function is not dependent on k, all this integral I can do, and I call the number, I call it c squared. And by units, you can check yourself that the units of this term, you see, delta k, delta due to tau k, is delta k times k squared. So to make the unit right, this term must have units 1 over momentum squared, because this has the same units as this. So this must be, we cancel. And since it's a number independent of k, I define this to be 1 over k nonlinear squared. Where c, you see, if I put 1 over k nonlinear squared, I expect c squared to be a number of order 1. Clearly, there is ambiguity. You can choose another convention, 10 k nonlinear squared here. You will have a c squared, which is different in my mind by a factor of 10. It's degenerate. Okay, so this means that delta due to tau, okay, is c squared, k squared over k nonlinear squared, P11, okay. Okay. Now, the answer, the true answer of the nonlinear power spectrum is the sum of all the terms of a certain size that contribute, that appear in my solution to my equation of motion. All the terms of a similar size, I should sum them all. I should put them all in. So P, actually, therefore, P1 loop is really like a P22 plus P1, P13 and P31 are degenerate, so 2P13 plus this P2 tau, the P due to tau, where P due to tau is the expectation value between delta 1, linear delta, and the delta from tau. In other words, I can write delta as a sum over n of delta n, where delta n were the ones that come from solving iteratively this equation. This was delta 2, delta 3 was the one with F3 that we wrote yesterday, and so on and so forth. But I should add also the sum, the delta due to tau. And even those I can expand in perturbation theory, and the leading first, there will be delta here, and this delta can compute to first order, second order, third order in interactions also. But the leading order, clearly I keep the simplest one I can get, which is the linear one. So the true delta is this. And then I can, therefore, in the power spectrum, there is also this contribution, delta 1, delta tau. And if I take the expectation value, I apologize. If I'm clear, please interrupt me and ask me, because it is followable. I mean, it's very simple. So this term here, is, if you see that I do a mistake, feel free to tell me. I don't get, I accept it, okay? So this is the form of the solution. So is this form clear? Can you shake your yes or no? Okay. Okay, this means that this, when I compute delta 1, delta 1, this will go like c square, k square over k nonlinear square, times delta 1, delta 1, which is, but delta 1, 1 is P11, so this is C square, K square over K nonlinear square, P11, OK. So now, the field P1 loop, so we, by the way, important result, we learn how to compute the effect of the stress tensor in the equation of motion. That is, not only we computed the effect of the interaction in the power spectrum, the delta square and theta square interactions, but now we have also computed the effect of this tau, this stress-tensor interaction. The full result is the sum of all those, this plus this. So pivot loop will be, okay, okay, neglecting P22 for a moment, pivot loop will be P22 okay, that believe me, okay, I can tell you, P22 okay, in this case, for the slope let's let this, P13 okay was divergent, and P22 okay instead is finite, is k over k non linear to the n plus 3 times P11 okay, so it goes like this. So it is not problematic, it doesn't have anything strange. So P1 loop, therefore I sum all the terms, P22 plus P13, and forget the order one number, it doesn't matter, so it will be lambda over k non linear square, sorry, lambda over k non linear square, to the n plus 1. And this as a functional form, which is k square P11 okay. Do I have another term of the functional form k square P11 okay? K is my variable. What are the terms that go like k square P11 okay? There is one from here, from the loop. Is there another one? From tau. That's exactly the same form. So this becomes plus CS. So I group them together. And then I should write the full answer. And then there are one from here. Okay, here let me put a coefficient CM, C22. And these two, which also have the same functional form, so it becomes CM plus C22 times K over K non linear to the N plus 3 P OK. P11 OK. Okay, so this is my answer. Is this satisfactory? Sorry, what? Ah, thank you. Good, yes, very good, thank you. Units are important, good. Okay, now, is this satisfactory? Well, almost, because now C square, you see, is given by this integral, basically is related to what was this kernel. This kernel was, in a sense, the Green's function of the Chermod, how the Chermods symbolically represent how the Schur modes are affected by the law mode. And this is a very complicated structure. I have no idea what it is. It's super nonlinear. However, so this number is a number that I don't know. And in particular, therefore, I can choose.
That equation.
This one, yes. You see, what I did is that this was the stress tensor. Tau j was the integral dt prime of the kernel. This was tau j. This is what we wrote. When we Taylor expanded f very complicated, we parameterized this with the kernel. So this is tau j. How it enters in the equation of motion? Theta dot equal di dj tau j. So delta is some Green's function associated with this 2x2 matrix acting on this. So it's the Green's function acting on this. You saw? Thank you. Yes, good. Yes. Delta T? Well, you can call it as you want. It just, you see that you can put a tree here to remember yourself, as you see now, that the contribution of delta tau goes together with the contribution that was coming from P13. You see that what happens is that the functional form. You see that what happens, very importantly, is that the functional form of the contribution from tau is the same as the functional form of the UV limit, or the UV contribution, short distance physics contribution of P13. So that's why we put a 3 sometimes, because it has the same functional form of the UV part of P13. And this is actually very useful. So the UV, the contribution that comes from how short distance physics affects long distance, which is how tau contributes, as the same functional form as the UV limit of the loop. Indeed, also that was the UV contribution. It was the wrong UV contribution, but it still was UV. So the functional form in K is the same. But this allows me to do an important step now. That is, C square, as I said, this kernel, nobody knows what it is. So I can choose to be C square to be equal minus lambda over k non linear to the n plus 1 plus cs r square, cs renormalized square. So that this answer now, so that the loop, P1 loop, I mean, this is just a choice that I can do, because CS square is a number I put, I can recall it, call it a different name. But now CS square is CS renormalized square, K square over K non linear square P1 OK, plus CM plus C22. And should say that CM and C22 instead are numbers that come from the integral. Okay, I don't know, 37 over 2, I mean, some number that comes out of the integral. One does the integral and gets a number. It's not cutoff dependent. And similar for CM, I mean, some number, and C22 the same, times K over K non linear to the N plus 3, P11, okay. So this K non linear is there just, you see, it's degenerate with the choice, with the definition. You can say that K non linear is 1 megaparsec, and this defines what CM and C22 are. So this is therefore, we get this result. This result is very important. In fact, it's the main result of these lectures, if you want. Okay, so this result is very important. So I think it's the main result. So if you don't understand it, please ask. Because what it shows that we can cancel the UV contribution from the loops by choosing an infinite or a cutoff dependent part to CS to contain a cutoff dependent or potentially even infinite part in the cutoff plus a finite part. If I do that, this result now is cutoff independent. Okay? So this result is cutoff independent. So it has a chance to be right. And this process of choosing, so this means that the CS that I call here, this CS is a bare CS. I call it called bare CS to distinguish from this one that I call renormalized. This I call it renormalized CS. I invent these names because those of you who took quantum field theory can recognize that this procedure is nothing but what we do in quantum field theory where we do renormalization. Renormalization is not different than this. In fact, renormalization has nothing to do with quantum field theory. It has only to do with the fact that if you use your equation the wrong limit, which is what we did here, we use our equation all the way to Q very high, so with a mistake, then you better choose the parameter of your theory to cancel the mistake that you did. So that's what renormalization is. It's not fancy, it's this. Correct your mistake, okay? So, but we can correct the mistake because we have the tau j, okay? And then we get this result. So this result now is cutoff independent, is finite, okay? And also you can see that P1 loop, then you can. It's a parameter that I don't know what it is. Physically, it's a sort of speed of sound of the effective dark matter. Yes, I'll say a few words about this in a second. Yes, a lot, yes, a lot. One at a time. So first notice, not only is cutoff independent, but also that P1 loop over P11, that is this correction, this one loop, which better be small, because I didn't compute, as your friend above said, why you don't compute P33, P34, all more? Well, I compute P1 loop first, which is up to delta 3, and it goes like, if I divide by P11, I get CS square, which is a number of order 1, K over K non linear square, plus K over K non linear to the n plus 3. Remember that n was a number between minus 1 and 1, with some number, cm plus c22. So importantly, this is much less than 1, much, much less than 1, for k, much less than k non linear. That is, it's not exact, it's much less than 1. That is, the result the nonlinear result that we computed is smaller than the leading than the linear theory. This makes is good, right? I'm doing perturbation theory around the linear theory. It means that the correction are small. But the correction to be but are they small? Yes, because k is less than k nonlinear, so this is small. Okay, but not this is small only because we put the CS term. They was able to cancel this. Otherwise, the P1 loop over P linear would have been even infinite large. It didn't make any sense. As in quantum field theory before they invented renormalization. It's the same. So to have a cutoff independent result and the result that is smaller than the linear theory, so it's a perturbative result, I mean a small correction, you need DCS, which acts like a counter term. Now, still, okay, so our result therefore is less than one, so it's good, but it depends on a free parameter CS in one loop. This parameter CS, as we just mentioned, has a physical interpretation. It means that a long distance is this effective description of the dark matter clustering looks like a fluid, but it's not a fluid without any pressure. It is effective, there is a bit of speed of sound. Or a viscosity. In fact, a disorder, one cannot tell if it's a speed of sound or a viscosity. They would act in the same way. But there is some contribution from the short distance physics that modifies how wave would cluster. And it's crucial because otherwise I get infinity. And let me just mention two things. So CS is physical in the sense that it plays a role, so it's truly there, as a meaning, the one of viscosities or speed of sound, you can interpret, but also it's truly there, that is, it does not make sense. It's correct in the sense, it's true in the sense that if you take the electric material, there is the dielectric constant. Is it true? Yes, it's there. I mean, I cannot do without. Of course, if you take the UV description of a dielectric material, you say, oh, it's atoms. There is no dielectric constant. And the same here. If you take the dark matter point of view, there are dark matter particles. There is no speed of sound. But if you take the long wavelength point of view, there is a speed of sound. That is, the two views, the UV and the IR, are complementary. They describe at low energy the same physics when they overlap. And the words are different, but the physics is the same. But if you take the word of the long distance theory, then you have to put this speed of sound. It's not that there's an option. And as there is no option for the electric materials. Now, notice that, let me comment about the predictivity. That is, what is the speed of sound? The speed of sound, we don't know. Of course, we know the order of magnitude. When we put, we know that the nonlinear scale is order 1 megaparsec, more or less. It's clearly not to 100 megaparsec is not 1 kiloparsec. It's around 1 megaparsec, canonlinear. So when you put canonlinear here, you expect all the number of your theory to be over the one. You put the right scale in the problem, then you expect the number T. But we don't know precisely what this number is. So the CS square needs to be measured. CS square needs to be measured. And it can be done in two ways. Other directing observations, that is, you go, you observe the power spectrum of dark matter, and you shoot the speed of sound in a way that fits the data. Has predictivity been lost? No, not really, because you can see that, first of all, the speed of sound enters with a very specific functional form. It's not that one can fit anything. There is this function here, which is a specific k squared p ok. That's a function that is very rigid, and you can rescale the prefactor. But for example, this, and so there is only the prefactor that can be rescaled, not the value of the power spectrum of each k, just this prefactor. That clearly means that cannot fit everything. It has some limitation. It has a limitation, the freedom you can have, so the theory is very predictive. But also, for example, this term, these are numbers, And since this term, you can see this term, n can be a generic number between minus 1 and 1, so it could be square root of 2 over 2. So this term is not degenerate with any counter term. There is no counter term that can change the functional form of this. Indeed, you can see that the counter term, this term could be changed by the this term could be changed by the counter term because this term is analytic in K. If you pull out the P11 of K, it goes like K squared is an analytic function. Analytic in Fourier space means local in real space. And then, in fact, short distance physics is local in real space, and that's why it can change anything that you get in Fourier space that is local. Because local physics is changed by short distance physics. So this is why this one can be done. But this term is non-analytic, which means that even in real space, it's a long-distance correlation function. And the counter term cannot touch it. So this cannot change. So this term, not only is a fixed functional form, but also the numbers are fixed. There is no way to change. So, for example, if the universe was this slope, one would, okay, we'll fix S2, but one could measure Cm plus C22 in the data as the coefficient of K to the n plus 3 and see if it works or not to the arbitrary precision. So the theory is still predictive, but can be measured, but not much freedom. Of course, it's also possible even, so of course one can measure the C squared either in observations, and by the way, the simple way to understand why the theory is still predictive is because dielectric materials, Maxwell dielectric equation, are a predictive theory? Yes, I mean, we've been using it for 200 years. Okay, but you cannot use it without measuring first epsilon. And we measure epsilon, the dielectric constant, and then we do a lot of physics with it. Here is the same. You measure CS, and then you do lots of physics, order by order. And then, or of course, one can also solve the UV theory and measure CS. That is, one can run this CS is how short distance physics reacted to the long wavelength mode. So another way to measure this is as to solve the Dermeter theory exactly, and in a computer, this is what n-body simulation do, and extract the speed of sound parameter that you do. And if you do that, of course, you get a value of CS, and then you're not free to fit anymore. This is the same in the electric material. If you solve in a computer the quantum lattice, then you get the electric constants, and you are not free to move it. Now, this one can do, and indeed we did it. Of course, if the theory is not solved exactly, for example, like in the Hello model or in the theoretical collapse, one can take some prior, can still get the value from this model and put some error bar and try to use it in this way. Anyway, one can use in several ways this coefficient, but there is nothing wrong just in fitting to observation also. So one can solve in the UV theory, and actually this is what we did. This is a plot in the notes that maybe I'll show. There's a plot in the note that shows you the measurement of CS, the measure of CS that we find in simulation. That is, we took a simulation, and we took a box of a simulation full of Dermeter particle. The simulation solves the Dermeter particle theory, and we ask ourselves, what is this value of CS? That is, we cross-correlated the tau j of Dermeter particle, which is the sum of the mass of the kinetic energy of the Dermeter particle plus minus, if you look at the, if you remember the formula, there was the kinetic term and the gravitational term. Roughly speaking, schematically like this. You can measure this in a numerical simulation and cross-correlate with, that is, see how it changes as you change the long wavelength Dermeter field where they live on. Okay, and as a function of the box size, you take a box size of order lambda to the minus one, and then as a function of lambda, lambda is an energy scale, so very high means small box, we found this value here, a number. Oh, these are all order one, and then if we change lambda, we found a different number. Clearly, in the theory, you must put, there's only room for one number. So how come this C squared is dependent on the cutoff? Well, because you can see that if you are measuring the property of the dark matter stress tensor on this box, it means that you are cutting off all the effect of the long wavelength longer than the box. You're not looking at those. In the loop that I just erased, in the loop, P loop, P13, was going like integrand D3K, D3K, D3Q up to Q, up to lambda, or some kernel F3 of K, QQ, P of Q, P1 of Q, and P1 of K. So the long wavelength description, when you look inside the small box, is given by the loop, but the loop up to the box scale, because the scale inside the box is described by the numerical simulation. So the change in this value, between here and here, is actually the change of P13 between lambda 1, say this is lambda 1, and this is lambda 2. The change in P13 from lambda 1 and lambda 2 of this thing. So this is a change, and if you plot how much it changes, you get this now, the curve exactly goes through the data. And then if you extrapolate lambda infinity, you get this number here, the renormalized one. As you remember, when you do renormalization, you fix the cutoff, and then you send the cutoff to infinity. So when you send this to infinity, you recover the number, this is normalized. That, for example, you can look in in data or in numerical simulation and measure directly from the power spectrum. So this tells you that this number is there. And this is another way to see how to extract from the short distance physics this number. This phenomenon here, how the counter term changes from as a function of the cutoff, is what is called the lattice running in field theory, or is a very, very close friend of the renormalization group. It's very related to the renormalization group. And then this is the classical renormalization procedure. Okay. Yeah, it gets a fixed points, but it's non-zero. So it's not a conformal. It's a constant, yes. So this is what the Fatty field theory is. The difference between before the Fatty theory, there were many approaches that were trying to do perturbation theory at long distances in the universe. And they are called standard perturbation theory, Lagrangian perturbation theory. There are many, many, many. But the only difference with respect to Fermat methods is that the Fatty theory introduces this stress tensor. Okay. But then you can see that this stress tensor is essential. So the difference is the stress tensor. But without the stress tensor, nothing works. Because without the stress tensor, you get a large result, even infinite result. And each loop is bigger than a Fermat 1. It gets worse and worse as you go to higher order perturbation theory. Instead, here we get a small result. And in particular, when you compare to data, we show you in the last lecture, when you compare to data, it works very well. Because this parameter you can choose to cancel the mistake that you do in the loops and to give the right value. To get the right value, and it works. So this is the crucial difference. Okay. Now, I didn't talk about P22. So is this questions? I mean, if there are questions, okay. So let's go on. So what about P22? I forgot to say, one second. So right now we did this experiment with some P11 of K. I did the calculation with 1 over K nonlinear cube, K over K nonlinear to the n plus 3, to the n plus, K over K nonlinear to the n. Now, clearly, the same is true also for the true universe. That is, this is not true just for this toy universe where there's a simple power law for the power spectrum. It's true for all the universe. That is, in the true universe, the loops are cutoff dependent and you need to cancel them. I mean, it's the same story, but just this is much simpler to discuss. Yes? Yes? Well, because it should be the difference between the cutoff, you see, the true physics is described by the physics inside the box plus the physics outside the box, which is described by the Fatty theory. And inside the box is grabbed by numerical simulation. So as I change the box, you're giving more box size, you're giving more space to be described by the effective theory. But the result must be the same. So the change of what you measure in the particle cross correlation should be what is given back by the loop. And then the curve just goes through the point. That's a remarkable confirmation of the whole picture. I mean, just to. Yeah, exactly. So this is the integration. Ah, no, you mean this one? Because this one is super non-perturbative. It's how galaxies know about the long wavelength perturbation. This is very, very hard to solve in perturbation. I mean, this is. We try to do this. We try to model this with some models like mass function, but they are approximate, okay? So we can try to extract that. There were some prior. They can give us a prior, but precisely it's very hard to. In particular, when we go to talk about galaxies, it's even. And this applies also to galaxies. Nothing changes. You see, nothing changes. If you realize, and we never had to say what is inside, we never really use it for the long distance theory. What changes, all the physics, the different physics short distances, is simply a change in ACS, as in the electric material. Okay. Now, so notice that I'm going too slow, but I didn't talk about P22. Now, you can see that when you compute P22, if the slope of the, in the entire universe, the slope is steep enough, also P22 will be divergent. And if you look at the UV limit, it goes like lambda to the fourth. Do I have it? So where I am. Mm-mm-mm. Yeah, we'll go like lambda to the fourth over canon linear you will go like k over canon linear to the seven, k to the fourth. So k over canon linear to the fourth times 1 over canon linear cube times lambda over canon linear to the right power, which it doesn't matter. Positive. So even P22 will actually has a UV contribution. And if the slope is high enough, it will be actually divergent. If the slope is not enough, it will be some finite quantity which still comes from the UV, and so it's wrong. So what is the counter term for this? What is the functional term that can cancel this? Remember that when I Taylor expanded tau, when we wrote tau j, we wrote it as the expectation value of tau j in the long fixed, the smoothed one on a certain scale lambda, plus a stochastic term. Stochastic term that had correlation function which were local in real space, so purely Poisson. We call it Poisson because in real space was delta of x minus x1, x1 minus x2, the correlation. Now, if you use this term, so this means that delta tau of k delta tau ok prime is delta 3 of k plus k primes times a constant. Okay? And this means that you can get a delta induced by delta tau. So let's see how this term, the delta tau, contributes to the equation of motion. Again, the equation of motion is this, that theta dot plus theta dot equal this guy. And now this guy will have di dj of delta tau ij. This delta tau has indices ij, ij, lm. And for example, you can put the most generic tensor structure, il, jm, plus theta dot. So if you solve the equation for, if you treat again this delta tau as a perturbation, you find there is, again, the result for delta induced by delta tau will be the integral in dt prime of the Green's function retarded from t to t, from t prime to t of this delta tau of t prime, which, for example, you can take, I mean, for example, here there will be some coefficients which are non local in time, some complicated expression. But again, since the Green's function does not depend on time, okay, 1 second. So we can do the analogous step as we did before. That is, this implies that delta or delta tau, expectation value, goes like integrand dt prime or retard degrees function tt prime. Let me copy twice for this term. The integrand dt double prime g retard tt double prime c o t double prime times the expectation value delta tau ij dij. So notice that, let me do it for k prime. So there are two derivatives here. So this becomes ki, kj. And then also for the other one will be k prime m of delta tau ij, delta tau lm. Okay, this is equal to. So this thing is a number. I call it c stock of t. Then this, I can plug this here. So I get, delta 3 of k plus k prime, which is there, but you see, is, I get the delta function translation invariant. And then here there will be a bunch of delta ij, delta lm, but clearly h1 is contracted with a k, or it will give me k dot k prime or k dot k. But since because of the delta function, k is equal to k prime, the modulus of k is equal to the modulus of k prime, I will get k to the fourth, k square, so k to the fourth. And by units, I can redefine c stock to say k over k nonlinear to the fourth. So delta stock, delta tau due to delta tau takes the following functional form, which you can see is the same functional form in k as this term. So one can take so also for the UV contribution. So, and therefore, P22, P1 loop, which contains P22 plus P stock. Let's call this P stock. We call P stock because you see this is stochastic, induced from stochastic delta tau. P stock equal k over k nonlinear to the fourth, 1 over k nonlinear cube, times the number that here was lambda over k nonlinear to some number, lambda over k nonlinear to some number, plus the stock. And again, the sum of these two, so one can choose the stock to be minus lambda over k nonlinear to the same power to cancel this contribution. So, and then the stock, we write in the usual way, minus lambda over k nonlinear to the dash, plus C stock renormalized. So also the 2-2 contribution, we cancel the UV contribution and the total. So every diagram, now we have canceled the UV contribution of every diagram, the total result is cutoff independent. Each divergence has found its own counterterm. They come either from the response, the response of delta tau, or tau due to the long wavelength modes, or from the stochastic fluctuations. And the final result is finite, cutoff independent, finite, and smaller than the linear theory. So the perturbation theory holds. In terms of diagrams, of course, we can write also this diagram for the counter terms. So remember that delta, so P13 was this term. So let me do first P22. P22 was something like this. F2, and then this contraction. And you can see that P stock, is a diagram like this. There is the Green's function, and then they're contracted by delta tau. So we represent the insertion delta tau like a cross with a circle, and you can see it's like shrinking this loop like this, exactly as in many books it's explained renormalization quantum field theory, is the UV limit of this loop. You see that if you shrink this loop to a point, you get the same diagram as this, which means that the counter 10 cancels the UV of this diagram. And similarly here for the P13, we had a linear fluctuation, and then a third order fluctuation, which was, so we were contracting these two and these two. And instead, the PCS, the one induced by CS, is it is a linear theory, and then there was a response due to the CS term, which acted on a linear fluctuation. So you can see that the loop that we had here, this loop here, is exactly being shrink here, and this is the CS. So there is an analogous counter-term diagrammatic representation also of the CSs. Oh, last comment I want to give about, so, okay, we saw that it's renormalizable and it is finite. So, and as I will show, when I show some slides tomorrow, Friday, it actually works. Now, the reason why it works is because, you saw, we parameterize in the most generic way what could come from the short-distance physics. So there was no possibility to fail unless we forgot some term. But this also means that there is only one theory. The fact that it's correct is also means that it's unique. So there are many in the field, that, since this emergent property of the dark matter was takes some time to find, there are many theories. But I think the true answer is that we should converge to one single theory. Okay, there cannot be two theories describing the same physics unless they're the same theory or equivalent descriptions of the same theory. So there's only one effective field theory. There's not many, okay, because it's impossible. In particular, let's see better what are the expansion parameters. So we saw, I raised it, but... So what are the expansion parameters? Okay, it makes sense to talk about the expansion parameter only after normalization, because we saw that before the normalization, the result is infinite, it's totally wrong. But the sum of loops plus counter term gave a result which is smaller than the linear term. But how much is smaller? That's our expansion parameter, okay? We can find them by inspection. We can inspect the loop term. And for example, if you take P13, one can find that P13 over P11 as contribution that comes from all, in principle, all phase space, even though the UV part is degenerate with the counter term. But in general, the counter term will not just cancel the UV contribution totally. We'll cancel it, but leave something which is over the one in the proper units. So there are three contributions from Q much less than K. This goes like K square, so include. And the contribution goes like K square over Q square, P11 of Q. Then there is a contribution from Q of order K, and this goes like D3Q of P of Q. I mean, this is always, P of Q is always P of 1 of Q, but for estimating it doesn't matter, because they're all nearby. We're doing perturbation theory, the result is not very different. And then we have D3Q, Q much greater than Q of P of Q, times, again, K square over Q square. Okay, so you see that since the universe was a simple power law, all these numbers will be the same parametrically. This contribution will be all the same. But the universe is not a power law. The shape of P11, okay, as you saw, is very, very complicated. there are wiggles, there is a change of slopes, okay. And in particular, this change of slope isn't really very nearby the nonlinear scale, so it's exactly what we care. It's exactly what we do observations. If one looks at the data cover kind of this region. So that's exactly what we care. So it's clearly not a power law, it's complicated. So we expect the contribution of this term. So this is the easiest one. We call it this epsilon delta minus. You can see, what is this? This is of order q cube p of q. This is exactly the size of the fluctuations of the delta rho over rho on a given size, on a box of a size of order q. So this is, what is this? This is delta rho over rho. Or in a sense, how big is, since delta is of order Laplacian of phi, this is, in a sense, is the tidal tensor, the effect of the tidal tensor. This is how big is the effect of the gravitational force on the trajectory of the particles, on the evolution of the system. When this is order one, means that the particle, the deviation from the free trajectory is of order one, is a big effect. This is the Newton force. This is the effect of Newton force. Okay, what are these other terms? Well, this is, you see, this goes like k squared. I can put it out. K squared times something else. By the way, notice that d3q p of q is indeed unitless, so it's delta rho over rho. It's a unitless number. So this is instead of k squared. This is a unit d3q, so it's unitless, divided by q squared. So it's units of length square. So this we call it, this is units of length square, and we call it epsilon s minus. What does it mean? This is the effect of, so it's a displacement. It's called a display, long, we call it long displacements. Why we call it displacement? Because remember that from the differential equation, you get the delta dot equal is over plus theta, the continuity equation that delta dot plus theta is equal to zero, which means that vi is of order di over Laplacian of delta divided by hub times Hubble. Okay, which means that the power, this means that how much one travels, delta s, the displacement, which is normally called s, is the velocity times the time, and the time of the universe is one over Hubble. So the typical size of the displacement, S square, is the square, is velocity over Hubble square. So we divide by Hubble and we get, so it's P of, is 1 over K square times delta delta, and delta delta is P of K. So P of K over K square is the power spectrum of the displacement. Here we get the displacement only from long distance, long displacements. So physically, what does it mean? We're asking, how much? In a certain say that there is some short distance physics that is going to evolve non-linearly, maybe collapse somewhere in an halo. And of course, if they sit on a big long wavelength, as time goes on, maybe this long wavelength induces speeds. For example, okay, now I draw it on top, but imagine that the wave was, sorry, let me just redraw. Imagine that there is a short distance fluctuation on the size of the wave. As time goes on, there will be this region will be translated. Okay, so this region will collapse here. Okay, so this effect that we treat perturbatively is this effect of the long displacements. Because we treat perturbatively because it's due to the effect on some wavelength of another wavelength, of another mode. So it's a nonlinear mode. It's a mode effect. And similarly, this object here is a mode coupling effect. And similarly, this mode here, this one is the displacement from the big, is the displacement induced by short modes, short displacement. You see, importantly, that what counts from the very, very short modes, what counts is not the force. The force that deforms a certain region is evaluated at the wave number comparable to the region. So nobody cares. The deformation on a certain wavelength do not care of the force induced by very, very small fluctuation. That cancels out. What doesn't cancel out is the displacement due to the short modes. This is a sort of random walk of the short modes that diffuses and becomes also the long wavelength. But the force doesn't. So there's a big suppression Q square here. In fact, you saw that indeed there must be a K square because you saw that the stress tensor enter with a K square in front always. So there wouldn't be any counter term if there was no, we don't have any counter term to cancel something that doesn't go like K square. Indeed, the UV always goes like K square. Now, last thing, this term here in the current universe is big, is order one. Okay, epsilon for our universe epsilon s minus is of order one. And clearly, it's not good that to respond something is of order one, right? It doesn't look very good. Now, likely, and there are two things that for more observable, this quantity cancels. Remember that this quantity is how much a certain region show wavelength, a certain region of a certain wavelength K is affected by the displacement due to a long mode Q. Which under time evolution, see this is time, it moves it, it comes all here, and so everybody's moved, it moves here, okay? So if for something, this is an IR effect because it's due to long mode, and it translates the whole system. Clearly, if you're asking correlation function among short modes at equal time, the fact that you're translating, it doesn't matter. Like if you're in a train and you're doing an experiment, it doesn't matter that the train has been moving. So for many observables, which are called IR safe, this term cancels. But for others, not. In particular, it does not cancel for something very important in cosmology, which is called the baryon acoustic oscillation. This is an observable on which many experiments are based. It is about measuring the oscillation. In the CMB, we measure these peaks, the peaks of the CMB. Clearly, since the CMB carry energies, and in particular the baryons are moved by the wave of the CMB, it's pretty natural that also the power spectrum should have this kind of oscillations. Okay, and indeed it has. It has in a way which is massaged by the gravitational evolution. So these are actually become more like this. When you put the right equation in, it become, and the fact that we are sub-horizon, there is gravitational collapse, I mean, even linearly, so they become like this. So there are these waves in the power spectrum. They are called baryon acoustic oscillation, which is simply the inheritance on the dark matter and the baryons, all the oscillations they had during the CMB. In real space, if I fully transform this and look at the correlation function in real space, which is the Fourier transform of that, the true function in real space looks something like this. Usually we multiply by x squared to make it more visible. So there's something like it grows at short distances, and then there's a big peak here. This is the baryon acoustic oscillation. In fact, that's why it's called baryon acoustic oscillation peak. Is this peak here at a distance about 100 megaparsec. Now, for this quantity, to compute this quantity, actually, one can check that this term matter, and this term is over the one. And so there is a technique which I simply mentioned, which is called IR summation. That is it possible to resum all terms of order epsilon s minus. That is to the n. I mean, that is we can solve, we found it's possible to find a way to solve non linearly into this parameter epsilon s minus. So, in reality, in this parameter, once we do this process called IR summation, This parameter is actually not expanded on, and the only parameter is this and this. So this allows us to introduce another an equivalent description of the system, which is the following. You have seen that we took the Boltzmann equation, we smoothed out, we expressed the stress tensor in terms of long wavelength fields, and we got fluid-like equations. They were not quite fluid because the theory was not local in time, but fluid-like. I mean, there was a continuity equation, a momentum equation. As you know, for a fluid, the equation was called the Navier-Stokes equation, or Eulerian equation. But for a fluid, there are also equations that take the point of view of describing a fluid as the volume, a volume element of fluid as it moves in space. This is called the Lagrangian point of view. Lagrangian point of view. Lagrangian description. For fluid, they are equivalent. And also for this effective theory on larger structure, you can construct a Lagrangian description. How it is made? Well, there is the universe full of black holes, galaxies, halos, very complicated. And we're interested in describing the universe on pixels which contain many galaxies, big pixel. So each point, each little volume element of a continuum, there's a continuum of volume elements, and they move. How do they move? They move under the forces that are around. And so if you take, so what are the equations of motion for these points? If they were, so the position, so that there is a point Q1, Q2, and I call the coordinate, I take some reference frame and I call this Z of Q. This Q1, Q2, Q3, so this is Q1. So the acceleration of the position of the fluid element called Q1 in dt quadro is equal to the force of gravity at the position where the field finds, the particle finds itself. Okay, there are corrections to the fact that we're in an expanded universe field like this, but these are very simple. We write the equation of motion of a point of a pixel in a point in the universe. But since the object, you see, we're not doing the description at arbitrary short distances, again, our pixel is of all the 1 over k nonlinear because I don't know anything about what it is shorter distances. So this equation is actually wrong because I should write the equation of motion for a system of fluids which are not point-like, but they have small extension, they have a small size. And if you have an object with a size, it has also, for example, a quadrupole. Matter is not evenly distributed, it will be a quadrupole of the matter distribution. And so when it moves under the force of gravity, its center of mass feels the force of gravity because it acts on the center of mass. But the result, since it is a quadrupole, it moves slightly different because there is a tidal tensor which acts on the quadrupole. So the equation of motion for extended object in gravity have also a correction that goes like d of qij times di dj of phi of z of q. That is, they move feeling not only the gradient of phi, but also the tidal tensor contracted with the quadrupole. And this is the quadrupole. Quadrupole, which is of order 1 over k nonlinear square. That is associated to the size of the object, which is of order k nonlinear square. So these are the equations that, if one are massaged, leads to what is called the Lagrangian space effective filter larger structures. That is the same as is an analogous equation that we before worked for Eulerian in Eulerian space, momentum and matter conservation. There are analogous equations written in this language. Now, this description automatically, so are the two descriptions different? Are they something different? No, they're the same thing. The only difference is that language naturally does not expand in this. It expands only in these two parameters. But But then, given an Eulerian theory, we can also do the IRS summation. The two systems are equivalent. That is, this is Lagrangian space, this is Eulerian space. They are the same thing. They give the same result. You do a computation, they must give the same result. If they don't give the result, one of the two people has done a mistake. Okay, so there is no mystery, there is no mystic in preference on one language or another. They give the same result. And it's a matter of taste is which one prefers. And some things are more clear in one language, some other and the other, but at the end, the mathematical formulas are the same. Okay, so I think this is time, right? It's about time, right? So let's, because I think I started a bit late. It's okay. No, okay, but I think this is pretty much all what I want to say about dark matter. The universe contains also baryons, so we'll talk a bit, maybe briefly, about baryons. But also, the universe contains lots of galaxies. I will show you how we describe galaxies in the setup, and also show you some the results of the current result that we have in this analytic approach. Okay.